Hello and welcome to Chatsa Television Podcast, Season 16, Xena, Warrior Chatsis. The show where two best friends are watching through Xena Warrior Princess for the very first time. My name is Alan, and I'm joined by a man who uses an axe to kill a mosquito, a halberd to kill a housefly, and a warhammer to kill a gnat. It's Magellan.
Hey!
That's for horses, buddy.
I got something for horses. It's a skyscraper.
What?
Like to swing to kill them with.
Oh.
Because I'm killing things with stuff that's too big.
Too big.
It's too big.
I'm using the planet Earth to kill an ant.
Yeah.
I'm using the concept of reality to kill...
myself. That's a joke. I promise you it's a joke.
Everybody. It's a joke.
I'm sorry.
Magellan, we're in person tonight.
Yeah.
So we can do things like this.
Why did you say tonight? Because the episode releases in the morning.
Yeah, but...
and it's also the morning right now.
Yeah. The masquerade. Xena's all about the masquerade.
Okay, that's fair.
Welcome. Tonight on Xena Chat.
Tonight.
We are recording in person. Nice job. John almost denied me a fist bump, but I felt it. Hey, everyone. It's Xena Warrior Chat Sess. John, how are you? What's going on in your life?
I'm doing fantastic. What's going on in my life? Well, you're in town because we went to go see the Sammy Ray and the Friends concert last night.
Yeah.
It was sick. Awesome. They're a great band to check out live. Mm-hmm. I had a wonderful time.
It was a wonderful time, yes. Mm-hmm. We had domestic partner of the podcast, who likes this new title, by the way. It seems like Amanda mm-hmm. is fond of being domestic partner of the podcast. Mm-hmm. And we sang and danced along to Sammy Ray and the many, many friends mm-hmm. along the way.
Yes.
Yes, so that's also what I've been up to because I'm here for that. Yeah. And that's pretty much it. That's life right now. Mm-hmm. We're getting into the colder season. I'm having to wear sweaters more often.
Brr.
And although we don't have a video version today, we can still briefly talk about our shirts. Speaking of concerts, I'm wearing my Porter Robinson Smile Tour concert.
Mm.
Tell people about what's on the back, because I didn't get to show you the back yet on Friday.
I'm taking a look at the back for the first time. Okay, so it says Porter at the top. By the way, the whole thing, it's like a tie-dye shirt with sort of like...
cloud pattern.
Yeah, and like kind of bubblegum color palette. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like... you know, in the early aughts, all the different flavors of bubble tape colors. So we got Porter Robinson in balloon letters that look like they're made of rubber. Mm-hmm. And then a big kind of anime looking face of who I can only assume is Porter Robinson. It says Smile Tour at the bottom. And there's other little designs around.
And Magellan's, what who are you wearing today?
I think I talked about Leroy's Place last week, right? Is my chat some maybe?
Maybe. Oh, wait. What is it?
Maybe I didn't.
You talked about like the board game stuff a couple weeks ago, but I don't know about Leroy's Place.
I don't remember. But there's this great wacky little gift shop, I suppose you could say, called Leroy's Place. They have a location in Brooklyn, in Park Slope, and in New Orleans. So if you're in either of those places, you should check it out. And they have a bunch of wacky kind of handcrafted oddities. One of the things that I have from the last time I went there is a hand puppet that's like a sandwich with big eyes on its head.
Yeah.
I call him Sam Handwich. That's his name. And then most recent time I got, well, Amanda purchased for me as an early birthday present. It's sort of like a beanie with like the bits hanging off the sides, and on the head there's a big eyeball on the forehead, a horn, and some wings. So it's like a giant purple people eater
or a beholder
beanie hat or a beholder. When I went to vote, but when I went to vote, the guy working at the polling place was like, is that a beholder?
And speaking of guys recognizing things, that the guy at the show last night,
yeah,
recognized your
shirt. So I'm wearing a shirt, a Leroy's Place shirt, and they have two versions of this. They have a New Orleans one and a Brooklyn one, and the Brooklyn one has a picture of like the pizza rat in the sort of fun, almost like a Ren and Stimpy art style, mm-hmm. you know, lovingly holding a slice of pizza, this pizza rat. And when I haven't showered yet this morning, okay? So I'm wearing the shirt that I slept in. relax. I'm wearing the cardigan I slept in. I slept in the whole outfit except the pants. I switched to my Homers, which are my pajama pants that have Homer Simpson on them.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
I like to keep it simple when I turn in for bed.
Yeah, and when I turn up for the podcast.
Yeah. The only thing I'm changing is the pants.
Yeah.
People have opinions about, like, pajama shirt. To me, every shirt's a pajama shirt.
That's correct.
Right.
If you do it right.
But some people set aside that they have a separate...
I sleep do that. Shirt. I do. I have a drawer in my dresser for sleep shirts. Uh-huh. But sometimes if I'm going somewhere, if I'm going to, it's also a, like gym shirts. Like it's sure. Just like
the Expendables.
Yes. Yeah. This one's Arnold. This one's Stallone.
Yeah.
And this one's Jason Statham.
Oi.
So
oi.
Moral of the story is a guy at the show at like while we were getting in.
As we were walking in, he's like, "Oh, I was just there seeing my Leroy's Place shirt, which was great because it's the first time I was wearing it."
Yeah.
Hyper local reference. Mm-hmm. And so I got to be cool Brooklyn guy. He's like, "I was just there." Well, I was at the one in New Orleans.
So he also got to be cool.
Yeah, he also got to be cool.
By being it from or visiting at least New Orleans.
That's right.
Anyways, that's fantastic. And you're fashionable as ever.
Thanks.
You want to talk about Xena?
I do. I do want to talk about Xena. I'm excited to talk about it because it was fun.
These were some fun episodes.
Yeah.
In particular, we're talking about Xena Warrior Princess, Season 3, Episode 7, The Debt 2. It's interesting because The Debt 1 is not called The Debt 1 officially. It's called The Debt. Mm-hmm. But I wrote it in our notes and in our podcast as The Debt 1 because that's what it is. And then after the break, we're going to talk about The King of Assassins, Season 3, Episode 8. Mm-hmm. Getting right into things. The Debt 2 was written by series creator RJ Stewart, directed by Oli Sassone, and it aired November 10th, 1997. Marge, can you tell me what happened in The Debt 2?
In this episode, after being betrayed by Gabrielle, Xena is carried to the Green Dragon's prison, where she'll await her execution. There, she continues remembering the days she spent with Lao Ma and the chance she gave her to change her life. Alan, what did you think of The Debt Part 2?
Some things I liked a lot, some things I was surprised the direction that they took the story in. And then they kind of did some stuff that was more predictable than I expected from Xena.
Okay, so give me something old, something new, something borrowed, and something blue.
You got it. So something old is the Eastern mysticism stuff. You know?
Yeah.
You have to give up desire and anger and vengeance to be an airbender.
That's essentially what's happening. They go so far as there's a scene where Xena's like, "Oh, you got all this wisdom." And then she starts writing down her little wisdoms, Lao Ma does. And Xena's like, "What? You're crediting it to your husband who you're keeping in a coma?" And she's like, "Why does it matter if it's Lao Ma or Lao Tzu who wrote it as long as it gets written down?" Lao Tzu, who wrote the Tao Te Ching or whatever it's called, right? The fundamental text of Taoism.
Oh, I didn't know this.
Yeah, I looked it up because I was like, I know that name.
Oh.
Yeah, the Tao Te Ching.
Okay.
So basically this episode is like Xena's lover invented Taoism.
What?
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, it's just a little subtle thing.
My God.
Which makes it a little better, I think, but it's still definitely, the sort of like you have to be one with the world and whatever, blah 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 blah.
You had written in your notes that maybe they hadn't seen The Matrix, but they had watched the same movies that the Wachowskis watched to lead them to The Matrix.
Because basically, she gives Xena like a "there is no spoon" speech when she's trying to teach her how to blow up a vase with your mind. It's like you can't like force it or want it to happen. There is no vase. Essentially, she kind of gives her that lesson, and the room they're in kind of looks like the room where Morpheus,
the dojo,
is teaching Neo how to fight for the first time. The color grading is somewhat similar.
Agreed.
So there's definitely something in the water in the late 90s that everyone's like, okay,
right? Because no Matrix yet, so
because this is 97. It's correct. It's not out yet.
So if anything, the Matrix is inspired by Xena.
I would believe that the Wachowskis were watching Xena as it was airing.
That would explain something. I don't know, maybe.
Yeah, I would buy it.
What did you think of the episode?
I really enjoyed it. This is a classic, like, part one of the two-parter. We were eating our vegetables to, like, set things up and do all the background so that part two could just not even really be full of fights, because there's not a ton of fights.
Yeah.
But they do a lot of the kind of high wire wuxia stuff that we were thinking was going to happen.
Uh-huh.
But it's more to do this, like, these impressionistic lesbian love scenes.
Correct.
Correct. Which is great. I'm glad that they gave themselves the time and the runway to do that. It made this half made me question the extent to which we needed part one.
Yeah.
Really? Because so much of it is like, really, I think, extraneous scenes of Xena and Gabrielle being like, oh, well, I don't know, Xena, should you kill? I don't think so. And it's like all those scenes are kind of the same. And then all this stuff with what's his bucket?
Green Dragon.
No, the guy that Xena came Barias. With. Yeah, Barias. It's like, he's barely in this episode.
He's almost a side character in this. Like he becomes like a C-tier character.
Yeah, he's like not a player in this much at all. So it just makes me question, like, could you have done a lot of that expository stuff from the first part in this part?
Yeah.
But I don't know. We liked the first part when we watched it, so I don't think it diminishes it too much. But I generally had fun with this episode.
I think the first one, getting everything out of the way with, like, here's the culture of Chin, here's La Ma, here's the Green Dragon, here's our mission.
Right.
Gives this episode the breathing room to explore the philosophy of Lao Ma and do some great fight scenes as well.
Mm-hmm.
It is not the like big 45-minute battle sequence that we sort of jokingly said it would be last week, but I actually prefer what they did.
It has the spirit of that.
Like, yes.
Because, you know, we've seen plenty of shows like a Star Trek or B5 would do this sometimes where it's like, okay, we're going to do all the setups that we can do a pew-pew space battle. And this is the Xena version of a pew-pew space battle, which is like
a talk-talk, pushy-pushy airbending battle.
Yeah, exactly. This, more than anything, feels like, instead of a Dungeons & Dragons session, feels like a Thirsty Sword Lesbians session, which is fun. Yeah.
I was going to say, for keeping up the D&D comparison, it's like you like start to multi-class as Xena. You're like, oh, I want to try doing like some spells. And they're like, okay, all we can teach you is like air push. And you're like, all right, I can do something cool with that.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to justify it in the story. So let's take you to this place.
Yeah.
So let's take the story there as let's we do our somewhat recap. We start with some like gallows prison humor because Xena's in jail at the top of this episode in this like, because she's still naked. So they have this like big block of wood gallows thing that she's in and all the prisoners are in, but it also sort of serves as like a cover up, which is funny. And there's some humor there. And then we kind of split her and Gabrielle up for a little bit of the episode. And Gabrielle's talking to the Green Dragon, talking like, hey, I don't think she wants to kill you. Maybe I can fix her. I can convince my girlfriend not to beat you up. Don't kill her for that. I think that would be fair. And he's like, no, I actually know her really well. So we get a lot of flashbacks of how Xena treated him when he was a child and how she was very cruel to him and like would lock him in rooms and, you know, push him out of the way and stuff. And he's like, I don't think this woman has the capacity to be a good person. Going right into the like major themes of the show. Did you like all this flashback stuff showing evil Xena?
I think I was still stuck on the Gabrielle plot not 100% making sense to me. Like, I don't know, just she's never to this extent undermined Xena in an attempt to like fight someone before. And I would imagine that Gabrielle's plan would instead be like, okay, I'm going with you, and then in the moment kind of like fighting Xena, preventing her from going through with it or whatever. So the twist from the last episode of like, I am here and I've betrayed you, it still felt odd to me. And I don't know, I think this one and the next episode, there's now this kind of weird like Batman moral purity of the very worst thing you can do is kill someone, which like, it's pretty, that's pretty bad, but I don't know. So,
but break their back and throw them against the wall and destroy a temple,
right? And like let the rubble fall on all of the guys without names or whatever. Like that's fine.
Don't or put him into that. A permanent coma, as she does at the end of this episode.
Yeah. So, I don't know. It just feels
that pretty... is very Batman, though. I agree.
Yeah, it's this arbitrary line that has never really resonated with me in other stories where they've tried to distinguish heroes and villains by like. Well, the villains kill, but the heroes don't kill.
Yeah, yeah.
But I do like these scenes where it's nice to see Ming Tian is the Green Dragon's name.
Correct.
It's nice to see, you know, not just what we saw with Callisto, where it's like, okay, she's a child who experienced this horrible traumatic event where her village was attacked and many, many people were killed. And so you can have some plausible separation of, well, Xena was raiding the place, but, you know, did she understand that she was having this impact on kids? And as a viewer, you can kind of explore the nuance of that. But it's interesting to see, no, she just straight up, like, traumatized this child and bullied him. And at a phase in her life where she wasn't being very intentional about her... like evilness,
cruelty, yeah.
So I thought that was a way of revisiting past Xena and her impact on people that was different than what we've seen before. And so you can understand why this guy would be like, oh, Xena, yeah, I remember her from when she kidnapped me when I was, you know, five, and she wouldn't let me have a chicken wing.
Yeah,
she sucks. So I like that. I like Gabrielle trying to wrestle with that.
It parallels Callisto in a pretty good way, like you're saying, and then Xena and Lao Ma in the flashbacks that we then get is also sort of Gabrielle and Xena, where it's like, hey, you need to, but in like a faster paced way instead of lasting the whole series. It's like, I'm gonna train you to not need to be evil to survive. You can be empathetic and patient and let things brush things off without seeking revenge on everyone who harms you, and you will find more power in that, I think, is the sort of general teachings of Lao Ma in this. Which, I thought that was some of the coolest stuff. Part of that plan is that Xena poses as a servant girl to learn to humble herself. So she goes, like, right... That's that cool sequence. She goes right up to Lao Ma's husband? No. Yes. Well, her husband's the one that's in the coma, but who's the one that's at? Lao Tzu? Yeah.
Lao Tzu is in the coma. You're talking about the Green Dragon's dad?
Yes.
Yeah.
Ming Tzu?
I think so. Yeah.
When she goes up to him and she is like, I could just knife him right now. Mm-hmm. Mama's like, I know you could and you won't, because that would cause a domestic incident. And I don't want you to do that. I don't think this is the time to do it. It's not worth it. And so they do a lot of that. They do the great vase sequence that you were talking about. And also, they make it kind of specific, because this takes place right after the Julius Caesar episode, where he crucifies her and breaks her legs. And so they make it clear that Lao Ma also, in doing this training, like, healed Xena's legs. They do talk about that at one point.
They do?
Yeah. It's like a line. It's like a quick line. Oh. But it's basically just like, you know, I helped you after your injury, pretty much. Because I think she still had, like, residual pain or something in her legs. Because she's walking at the beginning of this, but...
Right.
They do bring that up, like, in a quick line. Lao Ma also reveals that, yeah, she keeps her real husband in a permanent coma so that she can sort of puppet the country, but also not, he doesn't die so that the other guy doesn't get it.
Yeah.
This is the only way a woman could rule in the kingdom of Qin, she says. Very on the nose, like, women don't get to run things here, which I thought was fine. And then the first time I watched this part of this episode, I dozed off for 5 minutes because I was on the train coming here, but I rewound and watched it again. And what I wrote was, wait, why are Xena and Lao Ma in the, like, sky doing, like, a kung fu fight, like, with airbending? So I rewound and was like, oh, it's just because that's part of the training and all that stuff. So they also, I wrote it in my notes here. Do they have to explain why Xena doesn't keep these powers?
I don't think she really learns them here.
But she does it at the end with the torture guy.
At the end, yeah. We haven't seen much Xena since she does it there, so that's, I don't know. I can't imagine they're going to keep, like, yeah, she can force push things or whatever. That doesn't really feel like it would gel with the rest of the show.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe she, I guess a way you could wave it off is like, that was a moment of enlightenment or serenity for her.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that she's like enlightened from this point forward.
Yeah. It's not the D&D thing of like, you unlocked a new skill. It's you did it once.
Yeah.
Or twice.
Like in that moment, maybe she got it. She understood, but she's still wrestling with that.
Hell, I just think for the sake of the effects budget, they shouldn't keep it. That's like not fair to them. Right?
Yeah.
But this explains where Xena learned to do like running up walls and big flips and
that's
stuff.
True. Yeah. So. Her superhuman agility and stuff partly comes from this. I like that we're kind of slowly kind of explaining Xena's mm-hmm. power set, so to speak, mm-hmm. to be nerdy about it. The next big test is that Lama brings out Barias, mm-hmm. who again, Xena's like, I should kill you. You betrayed me like twice, dude. We talked about this. Mm-hmm. And again, Lama's like, what if you guys didn't kill each other? I'm going to keep these two idiot bisexuals in a room and see if anybody pulls a knife. And they both get angry. And I think they also even bring in Ming-Tzu at one point. And there's like a whole like dice game to determine her fate. This is kind of nothing. It's just like, we're going to determine the fate of Xena. And then it works in her favor, but they don't support the results. You know, there's that whole thing.
Yeah, it's a weird... it feels a little bit arbitrary. I like the symbolism of it, because the reason they come together is to try to broker some kind of peace agreement or something
that
ends up going south. But the argument from Ming-Tzu is like, well, you know, I own her. She works for me. Bryce says, well, I brought her here. Lao Ma's
like,
well,
I died for her. And then Lao goes, me, I loved her.
And me. I'm the damn fool that shot him.
Yeah.
And then Xena's like, well, I have some claim to myself, which is a fun, interesting little line. And then she wins.
And then Lao Ma's like, none of you wins. Also, she like throws them back and forth, right? She like tosses Barias into a corner and Xena into a corner.
Yeah. I think that's after Xena like stabs the guy.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yes, correct. She does fully stab.
Because she demands that part of the winnings is everybody gives a body part to the person who wins.
Saw looking ass.
And Bryce is like, oh, Xena, you can have my heart.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I think it functions on one level in this metaphor of the episode, which is like, this is the moment in Xena's life where she starts to understand that she has control over her own fate and destiny.
Yeah.
And she ends up making the wrong choice with that control. Like, I think she comes into the story here in the Kingdom of Qin, mm-hmm. just sort of going with the flow of being in Barias's, you know, band of warriors.
Yeah.
And she exits the story being like, because it's Lao Ma who says, oh, you could be my warrior princess. So this is sort of where I think Xena starts to understand who she is and how she can be the agent of her own destiny. So in that way, I think the game of chance is cool, because Xena is sort of saying like, I'm going to choose my future for myself, but then she ends up making the wrong choice.
Right.
Yeah.
She still chooses violence at that moment. It's the point is like, this is a step along the train, a major step.
Yeah.
And she learns some things, but she doesn't come out of it fully formed, because then we wouldn't have a show.
Yeah, and I think that's actually a pretty brilliant way to do... It's so hard to do character growth...
In a flashback.
And what they've had to do before for Xena is, like, here's how she got all fucked up and evil.
Yeah.
Like, she was good, and then her village got killed, and then Caesar really killed her lover, and da-da-da-da. But yeah, it's hard to do, like you're saying... Okay, now how does she become more good, but not too good, that we then have to say, well, but then she regressed, and kind of invalidate the first season of the show.
Yeah.
So I thought they actually did a pretty brilliant job of depicting a kind of growth that is like prerequisite, but is not the same as what she's doing now.
It's not final.
Yeah.
That's really how progress works in the real life too, right? It's not linear. You get worse and then you get better and then you get much worse and then you get a little better.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, you're moving forward. And we move back into the present And this is all Xena telling the story to Gabrielle in shackles. There's mm-hmm. also another prisoner she meets. This part's unnecessary. Mm-hmm. He's just somebody who also was in the palace at one point, so it gives us more perspective. But I noted funnily that this is when Xena says, "And that's the debt." And I was like, "No, wait. You got to explain that. You can't just say the title of the episode and not tell me what exactly you meant." Mm-hmm. And so I rolled this scene back too a couple of times to okay. really understand what she meant.
Okay.
She's saying the things that Lao Ma taught her gave her a rebirth. So she owes Lao Ma because she gave her this. I have a debt to her. Because mm-hmm. she helped me. In turn, I'm going to help not ruin her country. Because the reveal is also that Lao Ma's doing all this like game playing and sort of palace drama because she actually wants the country, the Kingdom of Qin, to be better mm-hmm. and like not put dictators in. And mm-hmm. so if Ming Tian becomes emperor, and that's what she's saying, I have to kill him. Because if he really stays as emperor, then the country, all of Lao Ma's work is going to fall apart. Mm-hmm. She owes a debt to her to fix her country, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
There's a great moment here where Gabrielle's like, all you got to do, at least in front of them, is promise not to kill him. I'm going to bring you into the emperor. Just say it. And like, please, it's not like this a problem. But go there. And Xena's like, I'm not saying it. And then Gabrielle screams at her.
And hits her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Strikes her. And just like, I need this. Like, you're going to die. Mm-hmm. And having accomplished nothing, we came all this way for this.
Mm-hmm.
And we do one more flashback. Basically, this is just the final Lao Ma being like, you know, no more desire, no more will, don't do things out of hate. To conquer others is to have power. To conquer yourself is to know the way.
Mm.
Big Western fortune cookie vibe. And she uses mental powers to fling weapons at her captors who are about to torture her to death.
Mm-hmm.
This was the moment where I was like, she's doing this in the present. Like, does she just have this now? Because in this moment, it's like game breaking, you know, mm-hmm. or story breaking. Mm-hmm. She's like got knives and shit about to hit her, and then she goes and like tosses them and kills the guy.
Right.
But that's fine. We're gonna allow that. And we move on to this like battlefield where, yeah, she's like fighting or briefly fights Ming Tian, and then puts him into a coma using his mom's brooch, like into the sides mm-hmm. of his skull. After thinking, they have this conversation where she's like, you know, Lao Ma was your mom, right? Uh-huh. Like, big plot twist, dun, dun, dun. He's like, I actually know that, and I'm so sadistic and so corrupted by my hatred for you and other people that I don't care. I executed her, my mom, on purpose.
And he's like, I did it myself because I knew yes. she wouldn't fight back against me.
Precisely. Yeah. And Xena's like, this guy's beyond the pale. He's no longer worth, like, saving in the traditional way, mm-hmm. but I'm still not going to kill him. And so we put him into a coma. She walks away, and we see his eyes, like, flash one more time.
Mm-hmm.
Do we think we're going to see him again?
No, this feels pretty final. Yeah. I thought that this ending was pretty good, the way that they revealed that. Yeah. Of, like, the camera comes around to him, and then you see in the side of his head, and his eyes are clouded over, and there's this musical hit, like, bing, uh-oh, yeah. We put him in a coma.
But it's not like we thought he was dead and he's not. It's just he's in a coma, but there's still, like, literally light behind his eyes. Like, he's gonna mm-hmm. live through this. That's the point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So they could just not return to this, I think, and it would be fine.
Yeah, I think the story's done. Mm-hmm. I don't know what else you would really do here, because what, he comes back and he's like, I'm
not done with Xena yet,
still evil. It's like, okay, man, I don't know, we kind of talked about everything we could talk about,
yeah,
with you.
That's the thing about bringing back people from the flashbacks, is, you know, somebody like who's the guy from the pilot,
Draco,
yeah, you uh-huh. can bring Draco back as much as you want, because he was the zero prime, patient zero Greg. And he can just come back forever because he didn't have an arc. Didn't necessarily have an arc, and now he's starting to as of the last episode, but uh-huh. but somebody like Ming Tian, it's like, okay, you did this for narrative purposes, this guy's done, there's uh-huh. no reason to bring him back. Maybe they do and we're wrong. Do you know?
I don't know, I didn't look it up.
Okay.
I mean if you brought him back, it would have to be, because in this episode, his purpose is like, well, obviously this guy is irredeemable
uh-huh.
for the purposes of this episode. There isn't really discussion between Xena and Gabrielle about like, well, but we could convince him to be good.
Yeah.
The episode doesn't really care about that. It mm-hmm. cares more about, okay, in the face of this guy who is a tyrant, who murdered his own mother, like, he's a pretty bad dude. What are you going to do about it? You're going to choose I mean, who's to say that, like we were saying, putting him in a permanent coma is chill? And because he's gonna die if he's in the rubble and he's in a coma, like nobody's gonna come looking for him. So I don't know.
I think I know Zeno well enough that I think they're gonna find my bet, if you're gonna like place bets, is that they're gonna find a dumb way to bring him back.
If they bring him back, then it has to be like, oh, we can redeem
him. Yeah, then it's that. Exactly.
Because we already did the Xena story
and
the arc with her here, so I don't know.
Well, it's Callisto, right? After Callisto's first loss, it's like, well, but she's alive. And so she comes back and she's still angry. He is not reformed at all. He comes out of that's why I'm like, they could still bring him back.
Yeah, but I think with Callisto, it's more interesting because she is a foil to Xena.
Mm.
Like, Ming Tian is not a foil to Xena. He's a warlord. He's another one of these warlord guys.
Yeah.
It just so happens that Xena's the one who created him.
Mm.
And she's responsible for him. But Callisto is like, she's a Xena character, but she had this origin where the thing that happened to Xena happened to her because of Xena.
Mm-hmm.
Xena didn't like lift a sword and kill Callisto's mom in front of her.
Yeah.
So there's some moral distance there that we can be like, oh, Callisto, yeah, it's Xena's fault.
But it was collateral.
Yeah. Often. And like, maybe you can find some forgiveness for her. And maybe there's some level on which the show knows, like, Ming Tian can't really forgive Xena because. Yeah. We saw her be mean to him. We saw her kill his dad in front of him. Like, there's not really a plausible, you know, path for him to forgive and reform. And it's also just not that interesting to see him do that because he doesn't mirror or represent anything in our main characters anyway. So I don't know. Does he come in?
Don't look it up. Don't look it up. Just let yourself be surprised.
Like, knowing if characters are going to come back.
Okay, fine.
Did you look it up?
No.
Okay. I'll look it up myself. I won't spoil it for you.
The end quote here is, Xena and Gabrielle's relationship suffered yet another blow, although Gabrielle doesn't know it yet during the production of this motion picture.
Although Gabrielle doesn't know it yet.
How did their relationship suffer yet another blow? Because she put him in a coma? I don't think that's fine.
Are you sure he's in a coma?
Yeah. That's the point of that. That's why he's still alive. You think he's actually dead?
I thought, when I saw the shot, I thought that he was dead.
But he still got the light in his eyes. Yeah. His like eyes flash white at the end. Also, one of the summaries I read said he was in a coma.
This page says that he was killed.
What? What a twist.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, do you...
So I think that's the point is... Gabrielle's like, oh, you did it. You didn't kill him. I love you, Xena.
And actually, because of the end credits are saying, yeah, she did. She doesn't know yet.
She actually did kill him.
Okay.
Which, the fact that he's dead, because that's what I thought when I first saw it, and mm-hmm. I like that ending a lot, because it calls into question, you know, how much has Xena grown and changed? How much has she really kind of found
mm-hmm.
enlightenment? Is it okay for her to have done this? What does it kind of call into question for us? So I liked the fact that she killed him.
My final thing. That's an arc that will take like to the end of the show. Is like sometimes you actually have to kill the person. Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same thing as Callisto. Like I keep seeing the parallels, man.
Mm.
You know, she leaves her in the sand there because she's like, this person can't be allowed to live. And I think it's too early for that arc to resolve for Xena or for her and Ming Tian's relationship. That's why I think he comes back and she's like, oh god, I let him live. I regret letting him live by putting him in a coma. He still rules this country in an evil way. And now I'm going to actually have to finish the job. I feel like I'm like...
He is dead though. That's confirmed. Okay. I looked it up. He's dead.
Well then, I'm wrong.
I'm not going to answer the question about whether or not he comes back.
Oh right. I mean, it is Xena. They could fully yes kill him and then be like... he had a bargain with Ares or Hades.
Right.
You have stray notes?
I got stray notes. Okay. I got stray notes. There's a real brutal moment where Xena's in the prison, and one of the guys says, "Xena, I hear you're betrayed by a friend." She says, "No, not by a friend."
Yeah.
Friendship ended with Gabrielle. Friendship started with guy in the pit.
Yeah, I'm finna get in the pit.
I thought the cinematography in this episode was awesome.
Yes.
Some real bold color grading choices. We saw that in the previous episode too, with like the red tinting.
Really
like
multiplied it though.
And in here, the pit, it's like blue.
Yeah, deep blue.
The flashbacks with Lao Ma, it's yellow and green. And the like wide shots in that scene where it's almost like a painting of the two of them kind of looking at each other from across the room. And then we keep having these Dutch angle close-ups, but in just like a calm conversation. I don't know, it all kind of worked. Even though there wasn't a lot of fighting in the episode, the way that the camera was moving and looking at things still felt action-packed.
That's a good way to phrase it. Yeah.
Which was fun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she invented Taoism. We talked about just a quick religion here. Gabrielle says, "My reverence for life kept a brutal tyrant in power and led to my best friend's execution."
Baller.
She goes to apologize to Xena, and the way that Xena forgives her is she says, "Scratch my nose, will you?" and Gabrielle does this great, I mean, Renee does a great job with it. A little like cry that turns into a laugh.
Yeah.
Perfect moment there. I thought she played that really well. "You'll be my warrior princess," Lao Ma says.
I wish they put the title card under that one, by the way. I really wish they did. Just, or like a little hit of like, da, da, da.
I love the, again, you know, I talked about this earlier on, but the sort of like aerial ribbon, like their way of doing a lesbian love scene where there's no kissing or sexual contact. There's just kind of like a cupping of each other's cheeks and let me wrap you up in a scroll and unfurl you and we're gonna laugh and smile as we fly around the sky.
Somehow arguably hotter.
Yes, yeah. It that was a sex scene, 100%. That's what was happening there. And Lao Ma even mentions like that Xena loves her. Like,
correct.
It's easy to serve the one you love. Because, you know, you'll think that it makes them love you more or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So I liked that that was textual, even if it wasn't visualized in the most literal
way. Yeah, it's a network TV show.
Yeah. Yeah, but I think those are my stray notes.
Bing bong. Well, we'll be right back after this brief musical break, and we'll meet our identical evil twin brothers when we discuss The King of Assassins.
Welcome back to Xena Warrior Chatsess. I'm Still Magellan, that's Still Alan. We're still here in the same place.
Bark, 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 bark.
Who let the dogs in to this podcast? Me. For the second half, we're talking about Season 3, Episode 8, The King of Assassins. It was written by Adam Armas and Nora K. Foster. Directed by Bruce Campbell. It aired on November 17th, 1997. Alan, what happened in The King of Assassins?
In this episode, Jax's identical brother, Jet, a cold-blooded assassin, is planning to assassinate Cleopatra, but Gabrielle, Autolycus, and Joxer intend to stop him. What did you think of The King of Assassins?
I liked it. I thought it was a really fun episode. I think it had all the ingredients of good, and it was.
It's a good sauce.
You got Autolycus, who's just fun to be around. You've got, of course, Joxer. You've got Ted Raimi doing another guy, and then that guy doing Joxer. You've got Gabrielle more than Xena, but Xena still shows up to punch people. And you've got Gina Torres as Cleopatra.
Yeah, let's go.
That's all pretty good. So I thought the episode was great.
A very young, fresh-faced Gina Torres, by the way. She doesn't I always associate her, of course, with like Firefly, which wasn't that much later. But she looked like she was 7 years
later or something.
1969 is when she was born. This is 1997.
Mm-hmm. She was 28.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but yeah, it's a bit of a different look for her, but a very similar like vibe and personality to, you know, your average Gina Torres character. I think if you're a nerd who watched shows in the 90s and aughts, then you're like, oh, dude, Gina Torres, goated, yeah. Iconic, so mm-hmm. good. Mm-hmm. So I just enjoyed seeing her. And yes, I will always take episodes of Xena where characters play characters playing characters. Mm-hmm. That's always fun to me. Mm-hmm. It's never annoying. And everybody in this episode's on their gay game. I did feel weird at first, yeah, that I was like, well, this didn't need to be a Xena Light. Like, she could just be in this. I understand the episode might feel crowded, but, like, she wouldn't break the story. And then it turns out that they did that on purpose, and it wasn't necessarily Xena Light. She was just cooking a big plan to save everyone at the end.
Was she?
Well, she saves everyone at the end.
But I think that was just her kind of... I think the reason Xena had to sit out for most of the episode is she's too competent. Mm. And this one needed a little bit of that, like...
A gaggle of idiots.
Yeah, like, oh, whoops, you're your brother. Oh, why didn't we notice or tell Cleopatra? Like, because there's that running bit where Gabrielle's trying to guess at what Xena would do.
Yeah.
And ends up... She and Autolycus have a disagreement about, should we just tell Cleopatra what's going on?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I think that's what's happening there, is, like, it's not that Xena had a plan, but, like, she's competent enough that this is a pretty easy situation for her to solve.
That's true. Okay. And she, like, would break the episode, is what you're saying.
She would break the episode, especially because if what you want to do with Jet is have him be, like, the bully older brother, he's a pretty funny villain who's just not scary to Xena, but is scary to Joxer, Autolycus, and Gabrielle.
Yeah.
So I thought it worked that they were like, okay, you know, Xena's going to sit out until it's time to solve everything, and then she'll come in and
pop her in, win, and leave.
Yeah.
Yeah. So many good parts in this episode. So many good things to talk about. I actually really loved the way it opened with that scene of, I believe, yeah, Xena's in, like, this prison full of, like, different men that she has put in prison, basically. Mm-hmm. She's like, oh, yeah, it's almost like this is the Rogues Gallery, except these aren't men we've seen before. Just, like, another uh-huh. Rogues Gallery. Uh-huh. And Joxer's inexplicably in here for stealing a chicken. And she's like, wait, why are you... How did you end up in an actual prison? That's so weird. I'll just pay for the chicken. Mm-hmm. Can you get out of here? And you're like, okay, that's Joxer. He's taken care of. He's saved. He's back out in the world. Meanwhile, Joxer is doing a heist with Autolycus, a la Mission Impossible is what they're doing, the reference here. Mm-hmm. The sort of dropping in to get the thing. But they're both masked. And at first, I forgot what the episode was about. And I was like... Does Autolycus have a twin? Because they have, like, similar builds. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, no, that's Joxer. Cold open. Or it's mm-hmm. Ted Raimi, rather. Mm-hmm. What a twist. Mm-hmm. And he's doing,
like, a Batman voice.
Yeah, Jet's fully doing a Batman voice, yeah, precisely.
It's pretty funny.
You know, we talked about Batman in part one. And this is the real Batman. Mm-hmm. This is, hey, what's going on? It's just him doing this the whole fucking time. Mm-hmm. If I were Ted Raimi, I would have a sore throat by the end of the episode. Mm-hmm. And then he's also doing that with himself. So you're like, that's weird. Why is Joxer? He just got out of prison. Mm-hmm. So it's a classic mix up. We get the, like, Joxer is now in the village. Autolycus is like, oh my God, Jet, I'm so sorry. And Joxer is, like, excited to feel competent and powerful. Oh, sorry. No, this is where Gabrielle's like, kill? You couldn't kill a time.
No,
this...
Xena says it? I think so, yeah.
I keep getting the girls mixed up. Is that because of lesbians or because of something, a secret third thing? I didn't expect this to be Xena Light, but last week was kind of Gabrielle Light, so it's working for me. It gives time for Autolycus and Joxer to be very stupid.
Yes.
Agreed. To be very incompetent. So that's that. This is a great sequence. Autolycus gets Joxer beaten up by a guard by being like, now really grip there. Anyways, here's a woman's butt. Oh my God, guard, he grabbed a woman's butt. And then the guard goes, you grabbed a woman's butt? What the heck?
Yeah.
Which is all just so that Autolycus can sneak past that guard. Because he's trying to get back the thing that Jet and him stole, which is a sword.
Yeah, I didn't quite understand the sword. Like, he needed to leave the sword in a certain place so that Jet could use it to kill Cleopatra.
Why does he have to use the sword to kill Cleopatra?
I'm not sure. Maybe they don't really explain it, because it's not like that sword does something. It's just a sword, but... they stole the sword. Maybe they're framing someone, and it's like someone specific.
Well, because it's revealed that Jed is working with the Ptolemy. Guard.
No, well, he's.
I thought it was with Ptolemy, like with the like head guy.
Well, Ptolemy is like someone we don't see in the episode.
Okay, the head guard guy, the guy with the green thing. I thought that was Ptolemy, but okay, yeah.
No, Ptolemy is like a Roman like political rival guy. He's like one of the triumvirate with Julius Caesar.
Whoa, okay. Disregard that. They do name drop him in this. That's why I was confused.
Yeah, I think what the supposition is, well, that guy is working for Ptolemy, actually.
I see.
But it's not just that Ptolemy's orchestrating it, but that the guards are the inside people. So maybe it's like someone is being framed, and so you need a specific person's sword in order to kill her. I don't know. They don't really explain that. They just say, like, Autolycus needed to get this sword and plant it so that Jet could use it to kill Cleopatra.
The summary doesn't, on the wiki, doesn't give a clear answer for this either.
I think that's the most plausible explanation.
Sure.
Oh my god, it's, you know, whoever's...
The big sword.
Sword.
It's also a MacGuffin, like, for the sake of the episode. It's the thing that we chase after and get it.
Yeah.
So, Autolycus splits off for a sec and witnesses the beautiful Cleopatra in a remarkably horny scene of him trying to watch her undress, but just something keeps happening. Mm-hmm. She starts to take her robe off to take a bath. And everyone's like, wait, cover up. Oh my god, it's cold. Some Joxer opened a window because he's trying to climb up the window that you told him to climb up. Get out of here, Joxer. He like cuts the rope. And Joxer falls on Gabrielle. Those two have something going on, by the way. Mm-hmm. I don't like it.
I was not a fan of this Autolycus leering at Cleopatra changing scene. Especially when you think about the fact that Bruce Campbell is the one who directed the episode. Yeah. So he's the one who's like, okay, get an extreme close-up of my face as I kind of bite my lip and say, ooh, yeah. Oh, turn around.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Make sure we show Gina's feet for extended periods as well. It's just like, what are you into, Bruce? What's going on?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I get that part of the point is like Autolycus is into ladies or whatever.
Yeah.
And Cleopatra is supposed to be like Cleopatra.
Yeah.
But it just felt it's a little much.
This episode's all very much, especially with Cleopatra and Autolycus, once they actually meet. Yeah. They start talking and he like sneaks into the room or whatever. They're going to talk. Uh-huh. And then here's some lines I wrote. She asks him if he's firm. He says, I haven't seen your bottom line. She says, well, let's take this business to bed. He says, well, we need witnesses because he wants the guards to be there. And this is when she says the line that I teased to you before you watch the episodes. Kinky. Oh, my God. Hello? These are two hot people. That's what's happening here. And I wrote, me and dot, dot, dot. Fucking never mind. I'm just sick of my own bit now. So he's doing that. He's like trying to wheel and deal with Cleopatra. And meanwhile, Gabrielle is trying to get through some guards and doing the, like, what would WWXD, what would Xena do?
Mm-hmm. She's XD.
She fails to pressure point someone. That part's hilarious. She's like, I stopped the blood to your head. He's like, no, I'm good. She's like, you have 30 seconds. He's like, I think I'm fine. I'm going to leave. You're in trouble.
Yeah. She says, I've stopped the flow of blood to your arms. And he kind of, like, wiggles his fingers. And then he says, nope, I seem to be fine. Don't do that.
Don't do that. Stop it. Quit it. That's a role fail is what that is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So funny.
And then Joxer runs into Jet. So we get the like stunt actor back and forth classic thing. Mm-hmm. Bullies him exactly like an older brother would.
I love this scene. The wet willy. And,
yeah.
Yeah.
You are famously an older brother as well. Have you ever wet willied your brother before?
No.
You ever noogied him before?
No, this was not my brand of older brother picking on younger siblings. My version of picking on them was, I think I've explained this before, but like forcing my younger siblings to pool all of our Yu-Gi-Oh cards into a big pile and go through like a very hyper-regimented, systematic way of redividing them amongst ourselves. Or like, okay, we're going to watch a DVD tonight. Well, obviously we need to pick, you know... everybody needs to pick three movies. Everybody gets one veto. Okay, now we're going to put them in a bracket. Like, I would kind of do that sort of thing and make them follow my little
The list. ADHD is coming from inside the house. Holy shit.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's so good.
Yeah, but we didn't really do any, like, physical roughhousing or anything. That wasn't really my thing.
I have an older sister. Uh-huh. We never did that because you don't want to be physical with each other like that in a harmful way. Mm. But I had, like, older, like, family friends who absolutely did this. We would, like, mm-hmm. Hey, fuck you, let's wrestle. Okay, we're wrestling now. And I had no muscle mass at the time, so it was very bad for me. But he bullies him, and they do name drop a third Mr. President, a third Joxer brother has entered the arena, and his name is Jace. And they basically just say, like, oh no, he's, like, weird.
Yeah,
like,
we don't talk about
it. They do, like,
Jace.
The ooh, ooh, kind of
there's
hand
a
motion.
Little sound effect that goes with it.
I guarantee you we're gonna see Jace. I guarantee you he's, like, a big gay freak. Remember Bentham from One Piece? Uh-huh. That's the vibe I'm thinking.
That would be great. I would love to just keep doing more Joxer Brothers. If there's, like, 10 of them, I would be.
Gabrielle's in a dusty black wig, mm-hmm. trying to be Xena. And she's like, I'm here to rescue Joxer. Well, she's not trying to be Xena. She's, like, trying to be a one of Cleopatra's women. I'm here to rescue Joxer. The guard is working with Jet to assassinate Cleopatra. Why? Don't worry about it. He wants power, I think is what it is.
Yeah, he's like told me he's going to make me a big cool guy or give me a raise or whatever. Some.
I wanted to read more about Cleopatra, the historical figure, because I know the last time I read about that stuff, it was like, was she actually, like, she's not from Egypt or something? Like, there's, like, a lot something. Of debate about, like, Cleopatra's actual heritage. And her role in history, because and, like, cinematically, you know, we talk about how, like, Xena and shows like it don't pull from history, but they pull from movies about history.
Right.
I think it's one of those things where this is, like, probably not how Cleopatra was or maybe even looked, but it feels right. You know, it feels like the old Cleopatra movie from the 60s, mm-hmm. I guess.
Yeah. I mean, that's even, like, you know, William Shakespeare is propagating myths about Cleopatra. Like, I think it's old movies, but it's even predating that she was kind of a pop culture figure more so than a historical figure.
Yeah, exactly. But this is the sequence where Xena saves the day. Well, yeah, I'm here to save everybody. And she, mm-hmm. like, takes all of these three, I don't want to say bimbos. She takes these three dum-dums and just, like, all right, guys, you gotta stop your plans. I'm saving the day. Something I really love about Jet and the way that Ted plays him, Ted, he's my friend Ted, is not only he does the gruff Batman voice, but he says, like, what is it called when it's, like, really dark, like grimdark kind of lines, but in a funny way. Mm-hmm. Where was I? Oh, murder.
Yeah. And that's a guy that, again, is scary for a Joxer story, but not for a Xena story.
Exactly.
Like, that guy is someone who gets beat up in the first three minutes of a Xena episode.
Totally. And then on the other sequence, he's a Greg. That's right.
Yeah. Quick historical clarification. Please. Before, when I said that Ptolemy was a member of
Caesar's the Triumvirate,
that's not correct. He Cleopatra's brother.
Oh, that makes sense with this.
Cleopatra's brother. I was confusing him with Pompey.
Oh.
Who becomes a character later, I think.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
The expanded Julius Caesar section of the lore.
Mm-hmm.
So great, some great action sequences here rounding out the episode. Jet gets to do stuff. Xena gets to do stuff. Gabrielle gets to do stuff. Everyone's having fun. We're doing, mm-hmm. we're fighting. Mm-hmm. And the day is saved. And this great final sequence where Cleopatra's like, yeah, Xena, you are so beautiful and so good at fighting. And mm-hmm. if you ever find yourself, I don't know, just walking around and you find yourself in Egypt.
Yeah,
I'd
just
love
doing like a random side episode in season 5, perhaps, if you want to swing by Egypt.
Did you look this up?
I'd know. No, but now I'm curious.
Yeah, actually, I am also curious if there just is an Egypt episode, because I think they could have way more fun with it. This one does have, like, great makeup, great set dressing, but it's not in Egypt because Cleo goes everywhere.
Right. I mean, I 100% believe that they'll go to Egypt, like, why wouldn't they?
Yeah,
you know,
it's fun.
It's the 90s that we want to do that. We want to do Egypt stuff.
She also gives Autolycus a farewell kiss. Joxer wants one himself, but he doesn't get one.
That's a funny moment.
She says, that was a thank you, that was not a kiss. My real kisses are a bit more intense. Bro, you guys probably literally had sex before this. Yeah, you don't get to then also be like,
I'm demure.
If you had me, then you would see the real me. It's like, no, you've already, we're doing it. They make this interesting point very much right at the very tail. Jed has to get sent back home to go to prison instead of like being executed in this country or anything. He goes back to Miramis, which is a weird name drop, but that's the country where the Joxer family is from. And he's going to be like tried by his father or like being taken in by his dad. So Joxer also has a dad. I would love to see Joxer's dad. This episode,
me
like,
too. Yeah.
This episode writes a lot of checks, is what I'm saying.
I want to see Ted Raimi play the dad.
Oh my God.
Cleopatra does come back. I'm not going to say anything more about it.
Fantastic.
Though. Yeah.
Jed does give some final parting words to Joxer. Be cool. Don't think about what people think about you too much. You're already cool. And that Gabrielle girl is pretty special. So, just keep an eye on her.
Yeah.
And then he gets dragged away giving two thumbs up, which is such a king thing to do. Ding. Due to the infliction of a severe wedgie, Joxer was slightly uncomfortable but not seriously harmed during the production of this motion picture.
Mm.
Wedgies. Has anybody in real life actually given a wedgie before?
I'm sure someone has, but not given or received.
Until today, no.
It would have been really funny if that actually was Jet who wedgied himself onto the wall. But it wouldn't have made sense at that point in the episode because he didn't know Autolycus was double-crossing.
Yeah.
But that would have been pretty funny.
Agreed. So anyways, really fun episode. Do you have any strain outs on it?
I do. I have a couple. So when Xena sees Joxer at the beginning, Joxer is talking about, oh, I almost killed someone. He says, there's blood on my hands. She says, looks like you've been pecked by a chicken. That's funny. I was thinking about Ted Raimi in this episode and how on TV he kind of looks funny looking, but he must be hot in real life. Like, you see him in real life, you're like, ooh, who's that hot guy?
Well, there was that scene in the, the Xena present day episode where they jumped briefly forward to, like, the 90s, and he was kind of hot there. Mm-hmm. Are you talking about, like, today, though, or just, like, in general?
I just think that there are some people who, on the curve of, like, I think everybody who's in TV and movies is much hotter in real life than we realize.
Yeah.
Because you just sort of like, you're like, ah, TV, whatever. People just kind of look like they're on TV. But then on the curve of like real life.
I forgot that Ted Raimi was in Twin Peaks.
good picture. So I think Ted Raimi is someone who, relative to other like TV movie star guys, it's like, oh, it's Joxer.
Yeah.
But if you saw him walking around, you'd be like, ooh, who's that cute, tall, cute guy?
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I mean, hairline.
Hey, oh my God, Magellan. Okay. He gave it to Sam, okay? Sam's got he gave Sam the hairline.
I'm allowed to say that because my hairline's pretty busted.
Yeah, I was going to say, we can all.
Whoa.
I wasn't going to say that. I was going to say we all can. They shouldn't receive it in equal measure. No.
They shouldn't receive it.
Oh my God, okay. Why is this the episode where I get bullied? I cannot believe it. I'm bullying you? For bullying you. I think all that's left for us to do is to make out and finally ease the tension. Not with each other.
Yeah. Autolycus being scared of Joxer before he realizes is really funny.
Very funny. Because Joxer like loves it. He's like...
Yeah. And it's like the only context in which there would be a scene between Bruce Campbell and Ted Raimi where Ted Raimi is the higher status character.
Yeah, for sure.
Because they're modes, like, Bruce Campbell plays higher status pretty much all the time.
Exactly.
And Ted Raimi plays lower status extremely well. But it's fun to see them reverse that, even just for a moment. I really enjoy the fact that Joxer, for the whole time that we've known him, has known that he has an evil assassin twin brother and never bothered to mention it to anybody.
Yeah, there's this whole thing here, right? Where he says, funny. Like... He's like, I'm the black sheep. They're like, oh, it must be that Jet's the black sheep. He's like, no, I am because I'm normal.
Right.
My dad is a warlord. My mom is the wife of a warlord. And my brother is an assassin. And my other brother is a big gay freak. So, like, I'm the normal one, which is fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that backstory. It's a little bit of extra information about Joxer that doesn't contradict anything we've learned so far. It just kind of enriches it. Because you could definitely do an episode where it's like, oh, I'm playing my evil twin, where you're kind of rewriting a bunch of stuff or cheapening the backstory. But this actually makes it work more and makes Joxer make more sense, I think. We learn also that the Joxer the Mighty song, because his brother Jet starts singing Joxer the Tiny at him. And
he like edited it, basically.
It's the same tune. And then Joxer's like, well, at least mom sang to me. So it's not just that his brother made this mean song. His mom sang the song Joxer the Tiny to him. And he's now taken this thing that was like his mom bullying
fascinating
him and turned it into his own theme song, which is really, yeah, really interesting lore on the that running gag.
It's Bunny's therapy.
There's a moment where Autolycus asks why is he here about Joxer, and Gabriel starts to explain. He says, no, in a grander sense.
Yeah, in the narrative, why is he
why
here?
Is he here? Why does he exist? It's funny. Yep, Cleopatra. Gabriel says, no plan is foolproof. Joxer says, depends on the fool.
It's true. So true.
Yep. Kinky. Oh, there's a little moment where Jet is pretending to be Joxer, talking to Gabrielle.
Yes.
That's very good.
That's fascinating acting, though.
He does it really well. Ted Raimi does a great job of that. Because, yeah, you can tell that he's, like, the deep voice is trying to burst forth, but he's, like, contorting and keeping it down. And he's like, oh, I'm the real loser. But he says it in a way where you can tell that Jet really believes that about Joxer. So I thought that was pretty good. He says to Joxer in a later scene, bro, if you saw evil, you'd have to change your pants.
Really good line. Jet plays Joxer, and Joxer also plays Jet. Because there's a part where they're like, oh my god, Jet, it's you, Jet, like Gabriel Autolycus. And he's like, hey, it's me, I'm Jet, I'm so evil. Like, that's fantastic.
Yeah. Gabrielle has some good fight choreography with her staff. She does like a boom, 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 fighting three guys at once moment.
Hell yes.
Which is great. And then my last stray note is there's a really cute exchange where Xena shows up and she's like, why didn't you just tell Cleopatra what was going on?
Yeah.
And Autolycus could have said, yeah, Gabrielle, that's what I said you should do. But instead he sticks up for her and it justifies, well, actually Gabrielle's plan was really brilliant. And, you know, it helped us root out the inside man. And then she afterwards says, wow, that was so nice. You know, you really are a thief with a... And he says, aw, go ahead, say it. She says, with a heart of gold. Uh-huh. And then they both have a little laugh about it.
Cute.
Super cute.
Romantique.
I love it.
Did I read the thing at the end of I did. The wedgie.
Wedgie. And then we get a nice little Jet redemption moment. Not too much, but enough that you're like, oh, we did the theme, the Xena theme.
I think when they bring back the third brother, they should also bring back Jet. Just do everybody at once.
Yeah, I would like to see Jet again. That would be
stack,
fun.
Stack them up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's the episodes this week, folks. Magellan, can you tell us what we're watching next time on Xena Chats, please?
I sure can.
Wait, is next week Xena?
Next week on Xena Chats, we are watching the next two episodes of Season 3. Season 3, Episode 9, Warrior Priestess Tramp.
Oh.
A priestess and a lusty barmaid who look exactly like Xena team up with the warrior princess when Ballas plots to destroy the Hestians. So we're getting another of those.
It sounds like we're priestess instead of princess, so I think it's...
Yeah, so we don't see the...
Diana or whatever. Yeah. Okay. Great.
Which I'm fine with. Diana was
the least interesting of the three. Absolutely.
Yeah. Then Season 3, Episode 10, The Quill is Mightier. Aphrodite casts a spell on Gabrielle's scroll out of jealousy, causing everything Gabrielle writes on the scroll to come true.
Oh, that's awesome.
Interesting.
And Aphrodite's back.
Gabrielle, a bit of a death note.
Also, this is now in 1998. They took a little break at the end of November.
All right.
So that's something to look forward to.
Mm-hmm.
You know what else I want to look forward to is hearing where people can find you on the internet.
You can find me online on another podcast I do with my friend Justin called Super Smash Echoes, where we play video games related to the Super Smash Brothers franchise, Super Smash Echoes. Check it out. You can also read some of my writing on my Substack at notthatmagellan.substack.com. Alan, what about you?
You can hear me on a few other podcasts. I am on the Creature Quorum on ScanlineMedia.com, where my friend Six and I are playing through Pokemon Black and White 2. We just put out a new episode this past weekend, which I hope you have listened to. And I'm also on the Garnet Wager, which will have a new episode soon. That's a reality game show discussion podcast with some storytelling flair. And then every other month you can hear me on Talking Marketing. That's a marketing interview podcast that I do with my volunteer friends over at amaboston.org. So... I'm also on Blue Sky. You can follow that one. It's aibrahim.bsky.social, aibrahim. So that's my new platform if you want to give it a follow. It's my turn to do the plug zone this week. Mom said it's my turn to use the Xbox. Mom said it's my turn to take a shower. Anyways, if you want to email us questions, comments, or concerns, that made me laugh so much more than it needed to. chatspot@gmail.com is our email address. We are on YouTube. If you are listening to this on there, we have video versions of most of our podcasts now. And it's Chats Television Podcast. Give it a sub. Give it a like. Check it out on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. Give us a review. That's the algorithm bump that we need and crave so desperately. If you have the financial means, please also consider our Patreon. It's patreon.com/chatspod. We're at $1, $3, and $5 a month. We have different tiers of delicious and sweet fun content for you, including the Chats Discord, where we talk about the shows that we watch, and we watch Doctor Who as well on Mondays. We would have just finished, I think, Series 3 of Doctor Who last week, if this is coming out in the right timing. $3 a month gets you that, plus the ability to vote on what we cover on Patreon. Every month, we do one thing that one of us picks and one thing that one of you picks, and the thing that you picks gets on a wheel, and we spin it, and then it gets watched or played or done. And then $5 a month gets you all the things I just said, in addition to getting thanked at the end of every main feed episode of the show. So as of today, our $5 plus patrons include Amanda, Arthur, Emily, Emrys, Felicia, Jen, Justin, Kyrie, Lee, Marcus, May Louise, Magellan's mom, Nick of the Brothers at Infinite War, Noel, Six, and Stefan. Thank you all so very much for supporting Chats. You're all very wonderful, and we love you. If you like our main feed podcast art, it was done by our friend Camilla. She's at Camilla Strader on social media. And all things Chats can be found at chatspot.com. That's our link tree and our sort of hub for previous seasons if you want to watch or find our socials and stuff. We are actually also Chatspot on Blue Sky, so there's your place to find us and hear about the show. I think that's everything, Magellan, but wait. I thought you had the thing. We have one final segment called Chatsums. It's where we recommend things for you to enjoy between now and the next episode of Chats. Magellan, what is are your Chatsums for this week?
The newest show that Amanda's been watching a lot of and I've been watching with her and really enjoying. I hadn't watched substantially prior to this. It's Sabrina the Teenage Witch. Woo! I love it. It's really fun. I love that cat Salem. My favorite Salem line. He was, Sabrina comes into the kitchen. This is technically in the episode where there's like a mirror world, but essentially it's still Salem. And he's on the computer. She's like, Salem, are you checking your stocks? And he says something like, yes. And if they continue to drop like this, I'm going to have to go back to dry food. And that's really
funny. Uproarious laughter. I'll edit in some uproarious laughter.
Yeah, I love
it. This is what the actor who voices Salem looks like.
I don't want to see a person.
He was also in Braceface. These are all contemporaries.
I want to remove that face from my memory. But, you know, I'm really enjoying it. There's a lot of stuff in that show that's pretty dated. But...
Oh my God, do you want to know what Harvey looks like today?
It's fun. Yeah.
Cool. Hey,
life comes at you fast. He still looks pretty good. It's his hair's all gone.
Yeah, exactly. He's got a nice...
He's got good definition on those ears, though.
Oh, yeah. What's going on there? Okay. Sorry. Shout out to Nate Reich, Richard, Richer.
Yeah.
Groovy. Sabrina Teenage Witch. Contemporary with Xena. Watching Xena and Sabrina at the same time. And Buffy. And then you would just be gay.
I'm jealous of everybody that got to be gay.
Let me tell you something, buddy.
Your turn.
Okay.
Chatsum.
I watched a wonderful movie for the first time that I probably could have watched when I was a kid. Have you ever seen the first Spy Kids?
Yeah.
You've
seen the subsequent ones, but
I've only seen the third one.
Spy Kids 3D Game Over.
Correct.
Okay.
My friend Matt had also only seen three. And his partner had seen all of them, and she was like, why have you guys not watched the first two?
The first one's great.
It's so good.
The second one I don't remember super well. Oh, no. The second one's good, too.
People mix the first two together in their heads a lot.
The second one is like the monster. He's making the monster people.
That's also the first one.
Where he's making hybrid monster people?
No, well, the first one, it's like the TV show, and they're like clay monster people. It's like people getting turned into like, you know, hand people and
is
stuff.
The... First one, is there a moment where the sister is falling down a huge pit?
That's two.
That's in two.
That's two, because that was in every commercial.
Yeah. And there's like a scorpion monster or something.
That's two.
The first one is with Floop or whatever.
Floop. Floop. Uh-huh. Yeah,
that's me.
Floop is a madman. Help us. Save us. Floop is a madman. Help us. Save us. Someone needs to make that into a trap beat. I said that as soon as I watched it.
Yeah.
Spy Kids 1 is great. It's... just one of those things where culturally, in our age demographic, you're like, I know almost all of this movie through commercials, mostly. Like, every trailer line, you're like, that's a trailer line.
Yeah.
It just subconsciously was in my brain, like, that's the line. Or I'm like, that's the line that killed in the theaters. Like, someone makes a fart joke, and I was right. The kids are screaming laughing at that.
Yeah.
It's very fun. Carlo Gugino and Antonio Banderas are so, so paralyzingly hot in it. Like, unbelievable.
As the parents.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then the kids are charming and charismatic. Alan Cumming's a great, extremely queer-coded villain in that.
Yeah.
Tony Shalhoub in a record-breaking role.
That's right.
Yeah, everybody's on their game. It's one of those, like, that guy's in this, that guy's... And then you get the little George Clooney cameo at the end, too. Just, why not?
Oh, yeah. He's like the boss or whatever.
He does the classic gag where he puts the black bar over his face and then pulls it off. He's like, I don't need this. It's really good. And it's like an hour 20. It's so tight and fun and good. Check out Spy Kids if you haven't seen it before.
Yeah.
It holds up remarkably well.
Those are fun. Those are fun.
I'm excited to watch 2. What I remember about 2, besides the falling down the thing, is I was like just starting puberty when that movie came out.
Mm-hmm.
And there's the credit sequence where she sings the song, like, I love, the I Love Dreams song. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I think I like girls, you guys. I think.
Yep. I had the same.
That was
same
a moment
experience,
for me.
Yeah. That's also 2's the one where they have the rival kids.
Yes.
Yeah, and there's the girl with the pigtail, the helicopter hair. Pigtails. Yeah.
Yes, that is in 2.
That's fun.
3 is just that nutty. It's just so fucking
Yeah. That's the movie that...
Elijah Wood.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
He's like the nerdy, like, really good gamer.
Yeah. That's the movie that, out of any movie I've ever seen, did the most corny, like, whoa, it's 3D.
Yes, absolutely. That more than saw 3D, which really did it as well.
We had 3D glasses at home, and I think watched it.
On home
video.
Oh,
yeah, with
just red and blues.
Just red and blues.
I gotta get me some red and blues. I might, because this is the thing. We were like, should we go down the whole journey? These are so good. There's the initial 3, which everyone loves. Well, mostly.
And then there's like a reboot or something.
It's like a reboot, and there's a sequel.
There's also Sharkboy and Lava Girl, which is kind of
that's good.
Yeah,
I haven't seen it. I've seen clips of it. But I know people love it.
That's within the same oeuvre, I would say.
Yeah, it's also, I think, like, similar director, similar talent on that one.
Yeah.
I think the correct machete order, get it? There's
a
good machete.
He's
1, 2, 3, Sharkboy, Lava Girl.
Well, also, canonically, isn't that
it's not.
Machete?
It's the same character, same actor, but not. It's not, like, same universe. I looked into this.
But they call him Machete.
Correct.
But it's not the same universe?
No. It can't be. That's like a hyper-violent movie.
I know, but that's the fun of it.
I know. The truth is, I think Robert Rodriguez had that character and was like, I'm just going to keep putting that character in things. And then he even made a second Machete movie, but it's the same. It's still Danny Trejo.
Right.
But he's not Uncle Machete, the gadgets guy from the Spy Kids movies.
Whatever.
I know. I'm disappointed, too. I was like, that'd be so good if they made 3 kids movies and then made a hyper-violent side sink.
That character wasn't created in Spy Kids, though.
That's the first time he appeared.
Oh, really?
In a film, yes. But like I said, Rodriguez had, like, existed. He had him in, like, scripts before.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
So he's in the first one, and he's their gadgets guy. Yeah, there's, like, a reboot, and then there's one that's, like, a reboot with kids, but the 2 got kids from the first one are in it as adults.
Oh, that's fun.
And then they just keep making them. But that's like, I'm not mad that they keep making them because, like, new kids, Spy Kids.
Yeah, there's always new kids.
It's fine that they still exist. But after I was trying to read about, like, what other Spy Kids movies came out, I got very tired fast. Anyways, that's my chat sum, is the Spy Kids first movie. I'll report back.
They made one as recently as last year.
Yeah, yeah. This is what I'm saying. This is like, they look like tots.
These are younger than the original kids.
You'd think so. Also, Zachary Quinto's in this one. Scandal noted.
As a kid?
No. He's Terrence Tango.
Zachary Quinto had a scandal?
Zachary Levi. I'm sorry. Zachary Not Levi. Zachary Quinto. My bad. He's Gina Rodriguez is the mom, though. Oh.
That's fun casting.
That's really good
casting. She must be great as a spy mom.
Exactly. Anyways, Spy Kids. It's like so in our wheelhouse also.
Game over.
Oh my god.
Game over. It's going down.
All right, we're going to watch all the Spy Kids movies after this, guys. But thank you so much to Magellan for being the jet to my joxer. Because, what, Magellan?
What? I was just doing a for the camera.
Oh, the jet. The camera that's not on. For being the jet to my joxer because he's, you know, a evil, evil thief and villain. But at the end of the day, he's also just, he's as silly as me, if not sillier. And that's beautiful to me. Anyways, thank you all for listening to Xena Chats. Peace.
Bye.
Flip is a madman, help us save us.
Flip is a madman, help us save us.